sing our processional hymn together. We sing, let's come together for a while and ask where we begin to build a world where love can grow and hope can enter in, to be the hands of healing and to plant the seeds of peace, singing welcome, welcome to this place. You're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of God to share, 'cause all of us are welcome here, all are welcome in this place. Let's talk together of a time when we will share a feast, where pride and power kneel to serve the lonely and the least, and joy will set the table as we join our hands to pray, singing welcome, welcome to this place. You're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of God to share, 'cause all of us are welcome here. Let's dream together of the day when earth and heaven are one. A city built on love and light, the new Jerusalem, where our morning turns to dancing. Every creature lifts its voice, singing welcome, welcome to this place. You're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of God to share, 'cause all of us are welcome. All are welcome in this place.
Amen. Will you join me in a posture of prayer? Standing in spirit or in truth. This is the day, beloveds. This is the day that the divine has crafted. Yeah. This is the day that the divine has crafted. Therefore, let us rejoice together. Rejoicing, Holy One, we delight with you in this day, for you have made this day, orchestrated this day, and ordained this day. We acknowledge you here, Holy One. May we rest in your presence, Holy God. Spirit, fall fresh on us like rain. Allow our anointings to drip off of us. Allow us to be able to be refreshed and renewed as we rejoice. God, make room in our hearts right now to hold ourselves, to hold one another, and to hold this occasion, so we may rightly celebrate this milestone, our ministries and our memories, made today and even before this day, and the ones to come. This is the day indeed. Therefore, let us rejoice in the day the divine has created and delight in it. Amen, and you may be seated.
Good morning. My name is Sarah Birmingham Drummond, and I serve Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School with the title Founding Dean. It's true. It is my delight to invite you into this service of worship. I am so excited. I can hardly stand it. I can hardly contain myself with joy as I look to you, our graduates. Everyone here and all of these participants in the service of worship in which we are about to engage are here for you. Here for you to celebrate you and to celebrate your amazing accomplishments in your theological education for ministry through Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School. We have some impressive participants in our service today. You can read their biographies and their titles in the back of your bulletin. I do want to offer a special welcome to Omena Priscilla. Omena traveled here from the future. Having graduated last year and now serving as a chaplaincy resident, Omena was last year's recipient of the Martin B. Copenhaver Prize for Congregational Preaching and has come to give us a word of hope for what's really going on out there. Yeah? Yeah. Omena Priscilla, thank you for making this trip, and thank you to your mother for being here to support you. We all are so, so glad to see you again. I also want to offer a brief recognition to two other people who are very important to the Andover Newton community. Tracy Red Edwards is here. Yeah. Tracy is here celebrating our graduation with her class, because you are the class that she first met and knew, and you are the ones who can say that Tracy is the only Andover Newton Seminary administrator you knew. And I'm just really sorry that you burned her out. For as we know, Tracy has moved on into a new role at the Office of the Provost. And we are just so glad that you're still so close by, because we cherish you as a member of the Andover Newton community. I'm also delighted to introduce the one who will not replace but will succeed Tracy in the form of one Anna Lisa Lubbert. Annalisa will be joining our staff on June 1st, but has already been working with Ned and with me this past year, and we are really looking forward to introducing her to all of the students who will succeed you. Go easy on her. This is a special day of recognition. It's also one of many celebrations that you will experience, graduates, in the days ahead. So I now just invite you to take a moment to center yourself in your chairs, feel your hips touching the chair, take a deep breath, and welcome this present moment, this moment of milestone. I now invite Dean Gregory Sterling to offer words of congratulations to our class.
Thank you, Dean Drummond. Graduates, on behalf of the faculty and staff of Yale Divinity School and of Yale University, I extend a hearty congratulations. You have done something most people will never do. That is, you've earned a Yale degree. But you've done it in historic circumstances in two ways. First, you are the last class, at least I dearly hope the very last class, whose experience will have been entirely shaped by the pandemic. So you have moved from what I called Hollywood Squares, the theological style, to a regular in-person experience. That wasn't easy. It's not easy to earn a Yale degree, and it's even more difficult during a pandemic. But you're also the very first class to graduate when Andover Newton has become permanently affiliated with Yale Divinity School. So you are historic. And I do need to say a special word of thank you to Dean Sarah Drummond for all that she has done to incorporate Andover Newton into the Divinity School, to the members of the board/advisory council for their courage, and I'll especially say a thank you to Linda Campanella and Hannah Kane, the two chairpersons who've worked so long and hard. This isn't easy. At the same time Andover came here, another school joined, a school not far from here, and just a couple months ago announced they were leaving. So you cannot take these things for granted. We didn't, but here we are. And now we have a marriage. Legally sealed. So my heartiest congratulations. You belong to a very exceptional group of talented people who come from a wide variety of backgrounds. And I want to tell you about one person, just one, as a way to challenge you as you think about your future. And I've chosen somebody from the UCC because that's the dominant group. So that's the reason for the selection. This individual really wasn't very religious initially and became a very successful attorney in Washington, D.C. He established his own practice and became the lead attorney for the Democratic National Party. And as their lead attorney, helped to establish the presidential debates that we watch every 4 years. He was the architect of those debates. But he found that his law career wasn't feeding his soul the way that he wanted it to. And he had an experience which shook him, a spiritual experience which shook him to his core. And so he left his law firm and he came here to come to Divinity School, not knowing what he was going to do, just came as a searcher. And as he was getting ready to think about doing his internship, he told his wife that he was just not sure what he wanted to do. His wife's name is Amy, who said, "I don't know exactly how you're going to find answers to your question. But I know it doesn't come from sitting in your room. You have to go out and do something. Get in the car, not tomorrow, right now. We're going to the DIV school to find you an internship." Amy's pretty strong. So they came, and he ended up as a youth minister in the Guilford UCC church there. United Church of Christ in Guilford, First Congregational Church is the official title. And that experience changed his life. So after graduation, he went, got a job as first as the associate pastor, then as the senior pastor at the Congregational Church of New Canaan, where he inherited a group of about a dozen youth. He turned that dozen into 200. And the church grew in a 19-year span from a little over 1,100 to more than 1,900. He absolutely changed that church. Then he decided that he needed to do something different. And so we invited him to interview for a job here at the Divinity School. And I will never forget having dinner with him in a hotel here in New Haven. And I said to him, "Skip, this job is completely beneath your skill level." And the compensation is not going to be anywhere near what you have been accustomed to in your life. The only way you should accept this job is if you feel called to accept it. So he came and helped to launch the Youth Ministry Institute and to serve as the managing director for the Center for Faith and Culture. Skip did a remarkable job here in those positions. The Youth Ministry Institute has hosted 35 events and served well over 3,500 people in person here on this campus. They bring 100 people from all over New England, volunteer youth ministers, to this campus. We haven't done anything else that's had this kind of reach to all these churches. But it's not only regional. The electronic versions have gone far beyond this. The online engagement has reached at least 73,000 people in more than 200 countries with YouTube views of more than 300,000. Now, I don't know about you. Skip did many other things. But I find it somewhat ironic that the architect of the presidential debates for the United States was the architect for the Youth Ministry Institute program at this school. But I'm telling you that story as a way of saying God has a great sense of humor. And I'm not sure where God's going to lead you, and you may be thinking, I don't have a clue right now either, and that's okay. But the one thing we challenge you to do is follow your heart, follow your calling, serve with all of your might, and let God lead the way. It will be an interesting journey. May God bless each one of you.
I'm an Old Testament professor, and I'm reading from Romans, but first we have to have a little bit of Proverbs. Does not wisdom call? And does not understanding raise her voice on the heights beside the way? At the crossroads, she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance of the portals, she cries out. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone, if it is possible. As far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will burn heaping coals on his head. Do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good.
Reading from the first letter to the Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the 1st through the 13th verses. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became full grown, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. May God bless the reading and the hearing of this word.
To welcome up the Andover Newton graduation choir. No matter what the world says.
No matter what the world says
or thinks about me.
You are a child.
I don't know about you, but every now and then I need a reminder of who I am. And God says, you are mine. Good morning. Y'all, I am so excited for you to be here with my YDS siblings. It is truly my pleasure. It is my joy. I've been smiling since I pulled into the driveway, which lets me know that I am home, and I am grateful for that. The scripture has already been read in your hearing. The sermon will be coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 11, and I just want us to put a pin in verse 8. And the word of God says, love never fails. For a few moments, I want to speak from the subject, only love will last. Only love will last. I am a proud auntie. I like being an aunt because I'm the fun one. The one my nieces and nephews can call to vent about their parents or to share with me the events of their blissful childhood. One aspect of being an aunt that I don't like so much is hearing that the children that I love are behaving in a way that is contrary to who they have been taught, or what they have been taught, and who they are authentically. About 2 weeks ago, my childhood best friend called me, and the first line she hit me with was, "Let me tell you what your child did." This friend proceeded to tell me that my niece of 12 years had engaged in behavior that just wasn't like her because she wanted to fit in at school. And as I'm listening, I'm torn because I know what my best friend is saying is right. And I also know what it's like being a child at that age and wanting to fit in. I'm sure parents know this too, and that's why they work hard at instilling certain values in their children. I'm sure that our graduates today learned at some point in life how to be compassionate, generous, kind, humble, patient, and bold. As children, we're taught these things because our parents knew something about the world that we had not yet experienced. They knew that the world could be cruel, unjust, unforgiving, relentless, racist, homophobic, sexist, evil, and broken. Our parents and guardians knew that once they set us into the world, that we would encounter people and systems and institutions and hierarchies so powerful that their influence could potentially change who we were created to be and what we were created to do. They and we as a community know what can happen when those we love are surrounded by people who don't have their best interest at heart. People whose lifestyle does not mirror the lifestyles that nurture and contribute to the maturation of an individual. People who don't mind taking advantage and manipulating and preying on the vulnerability of others. Unless you think that children are the only ones subjected to pressures to conform, the only ones trying to navigate a world that operates counter to who they are and who they are trying to become, let me introduce you to some adults in Corinth that Paul is writing to in our text today. In chapter 13, Paul provides us with key insight on how to live in a world that seems to lack a moral compass. Allow me to give you some context before the content. Though Paul founded the church in Corinth back in Acts 18, he's been away long enough for new problems and serious misunderstandings to arise within the community. So he writes to the people to adjust their understanding of what it means to operate in Christ and to reinforce an ethos centered on Christ crucified and the resurrection. Paul is faced with a massive task of re-socialization. He has to reshape the moral imaginations of Gentile converts into a pattern of life that aligns with the God of Israel. And beloved, this is a major task because although Corinth was a Greek city, Its laws, its political structures, and cultural customs were significantly determined by its orientation toward Rome. There in 1 Corinthians, the people are exposed to immoral behavior, idolatry, wayward lifestyles, and loose attitudes. This is a newly formed group learning what it means to operate as a community with a new shared ethos and social identity. But there are divisions within the community. People have questions concerning sexual immorality, legal disputes, the Lord's Supper, and eating meat that has been offered to idols, and spiritual gifts. The Corinthians are struggling to figure out who they are in relation to their God, who they are in relation to their neighbors, while living in a place that does not reflect their values. Paul takes all of this and their questions and concerns into consideration, and he uses chapters 1 through 11 to address all of them. He then pivots and centers the next three chapters on spiritual gifts and the relation to love. And I would argue that chapter 13 is the most important because here is where Paul humbles us. Most people are familiar with chapter 13 because they like to use verses 4 through 7 to define and assess their romantic relationships. But that's not what Paul was writing about. Paul was concerned with how the Corinthians were functioning in a community. He emphasizes that love was to become a defining characteristic of this community, which is a contrast to their broader civic community. Paul knew that maintaining a Christ-centered ethos was difficult when the surrounding community did not align with the Corinthians, what they now believed and what they were called into. And I believe that Paul's lesson is timely for our graduates today, because the truth is that you all are going into a new world. The world that you left is not the same world that you are matriculating into. It is not the same world that you came into your first semester at YDS. The communities you'll inhabit will need someone willing to operate opposite the world and declare there will be love here. And if that's you, and I'm hoping that it is, Paul says that there are some things you need to know. No matter what the world might be doing, Paul says, when it comes to the relationship you have with your community, know that if your spiritual gifts are not grounded in love, they are meaningless. Contrary to what folks might think, love is more than having an affection, an attraction for someone else. In his classic work, The Art of Loving, psychoanalyst and social philosopher Erich Fromm says that love is, quote, the active concern for the life and growth of that which we love. And where concern is lacking, there is no love, end quote. So the question to my siblings today is, how are you going to be using your gift when you leave here? Who gets to benefit from what God has placed inside of you? How is your community going to be better because of your gift? And if your gift is not being used for the edification of the community, what are you doing? Beloved, your gift should not just make room for you, but it ought to make room for other people. But the fact remains that there are people who have been given spiritual gifts and yet have no idea what love is. You cannot claim to love people and restrict transgender students from using bathrooms that align with their gender identities. Don't tell me you love people and help to raise millions of dollars to cover the legal fees of a murderer. You cannot love people and require migrants to prove that they couldn't find asylum anywhere else before letting them in to this country. Beloved, you don't know what love is if you are committed to eradicating diversity, equity, inclusion in our public schools and academic institutions. The life and growth of God's people are the furthest thing from your mind if you would allow this country to enter into a recession rather than to raise the debt ceiling. If you truly love your community, the well-being of them and their families should govern every decision that you make. Their needs should inform every project you create, and this degree from Yale that you all are about to get should not just be for your own edification, but the growth of your community. Paul emphasizes that it doesn't matter what your spiritual gift is. You've got to embody an ethic of love. Otherwise, you're just making noise. When it comes to community, the second thing you should know is that learning to love takes practice. I know, someone somewhere told you that loving others is just something that we do, but it isn't. Paul's description of the attributes of love in verses 4-7 offers us a picture of habitual actions and dispositions. I have the pleasure of learning from couples in the hospital where I am in Nashville who have been married for decades. And I always ask them, what is the secret to a healthy relationship? And believe it or not, they all mention the same thing. Every day, I make a choice to love. If Fromm is right, and love is indeed an action, then that means that love is a conscious decision that we make. In her book, All About Love, author and poet Bell Hooks writes, quote, "The choice to love is a choice to connect, to find ourselves in the other," end quote. I choose to connect with you. When I choose to connect with you, I am willing to risk knowing myself better than I ever have before. When I choose to know you, I am choosing to be vulnerable enough to discover who I really am. As I offer you the most beautiful gift that I have, I learn that I don't love you because you love me. I love you because love is who I am. Beloved, love, learning to love, takes discipline. It does not require you to be perfect, but it does require effort. Every day we wake up, we must be committed to learning how not to keep a record of wrongs. We must be open to what it means not to dishonor others. We say yes to a love that always trusts, always hopes, and perseveres. And the good news is that these learned patterns of behavior have the benefit of being practiced in community. When it comes to community, the third thing you need to understand is that you don't know everything. I'm gonna cut across the field here. One of the things that I don't want you all to walk away believing is that your spiritual gifts are not of value. On the contrary, they are so valuable that they were given knowing that the church, indeed the world, because the church is the world is the church, that the world would need them. What Paul does is deprioritizes your gifts under the value of love. One of the problems with the Corinthians was their over-identification with Rome's prestigious claim to an empire without end. He says that the only thing that never ends is love. To know love, and to know love fully, takes a lifetime. Which means that there is grace for those of us who are currently engaged in the act of loving. In verses 8-11, Paul shares with the Corinthians that although he doesn't want them to place so much importance on spiritual gifts, he says that those who have them don't even understand them fully. He doesn't want them to think that gifts are all there is, for they are only temporary. And in reflection, I thought about why God would only provide us with a partial understanding of what they've provided. And I wonder if knowing the full extent of the power that we have would lead us to abuse what God has given us. Just look at what people do with the partial power they have now. I recently heard a minister tell her congregation that while the debt of pursuing her PhD was hers, the degree belonged to everyone under the sound of her voice. In spite of this world's current state of affairs, siblings, our communities don't just need us to be good at raising money. They don't need you to just be good at leading a church, or giving a decent lecture, or writing really great books, or serving in a leadership position at a prestigious academic institution. More than a few letters after your name, more than your degrees and accomplishments, you are not called to conform to this world, but to love as Christ loves us, because only love will last. Ashe and amen.
Important prizes that will be conferred this weekend will be your Yale Divinity School degrees and your Andover Newton diplomas. Together, those two recognitions signify that you are highly educated in all matters theological and religious, and when it comes to the life of ministry, you're as ready as you'll ever be. Before conferring prizes in the form of diplomas, We set aside a moment in these ceremonies to recognize some special achievements among our graduates. The first two prizes will be presented by those who won them previously, Ned Allen Parker and JaQuan K. Beachem.
As our preacher has already named, this world that we live in requires moral leadership, love, and attention. This prize that I am about to offer is in recognition of excellence at the intersection of ministry and theological scholarship. Read, moral leadership and love without end. And I am very honored to confer it upon Clara Sims.
So the jury is still out on what makes a good preacher or preaching. Is it style? Is it doctrine? Is it a hoop or a holler? For our purposes today, preaching will be thought of as theologically grounded preaching and teaching that propels community into new territory, acknowledging those who maybe historically were overlooked. Today, we confer the Martin B. Copenhaver Preaching Prize to one in recognition of exceptional achievement in and promise for outstanding preaching upon Daryl Hopkins Donnell. Which also means that Daryl Hopkins Donnell will be our 2024 preacher and presider.
Start writing, Daryl. As Dean Sterling mentioned previously, this is Andover Newton's first year as a fully embedded unit here at Yale Divinity School. And part of the project of becoming an embedded unit is blending traditions from our historic school and Yale, a much younger one. At Andover Newton Seminary in Newton, we had a faculty marshal lead processions at graduation. They had a stick and everything. Both of these gentlemen served in that capacity, as did I. But when we got here, we learned that Yale had a tradition of student marshals leading processions, and so we thought a good blend would be to recognize a marshal, but in a new way. Furthermore, we at Andover Newton teach ministry in the congregational way. Congregational ministry is all about bringing people together and taking them someplace new. They're not shepherds. Jesus is the shepherd. But they're sheepdogs who watch where the shepherd is going and keep the community together as it moves forward. Our student marshal immortalized on this plaque.
I know.
Is the person who will carry the cross out of our sanctuary after this graduation and will be recognized in perpetuity in our office space. The student marshal is designated by the faculty as the one they understand as the class's spiritual leader, the one among graduates who embodies congregational ministry, defined by its flat hierarchies, sharing of leadership, attention to context, and conviction that relationships are everything. Your 2023 class marshal is Sarah Nicole Menard. Invite my colleagues, Ned and JaQuan, to come behind this table, and affiliated faculty members, Professors Mobley and Heim, to come to the front of the sanctuary, and Jeff Hagray from our advisory council to begin the presentation of diplomas and medals. Diplomas and medals. Both your medals, students about to be graduates, and your diplomas bear our school seal. When you receive your diploma and you see its embossing, when you see your medal, you'll see that every image tells part of the story of our seminary's rich history. You are now part of this history. We ask that you wear your medals today, and that you wear them to the post-graduation luncheon celebration to which you're all invited in the old common room. We ask that you wear your medals on your graduation day on Monday, to your ordination, to your installation, to your coronation, on your next vacation. We want you to wear them with pride, and as a sign of acceptance of your emerging and beautiful sense of call. We are all called to be of service in making the world more as God intends it to be. And this will be the seal and the mark that you have said yes. I'll now say the names of those receiving their diplomas and their medals. If Professors Heim and Mobley could go forward, you're going to put the medals on students. And Dr. Hagray, if you could stand here and hand the diplomas. I'll read your name and you'll just go around in a circle and back to your seat. I'd say hold our applause, but who are we kidding? Ryan Lindsay Arendell. Meredith Christine Barges. Tasha Nicole Brownfield. Christine Marie Cavan Geeting. Julie Ann Center. Countess Clark Cooper. Daryl Hopkins Donnell. Mark Ryan Dingler. Tamara Yvette for Ravello. Benjamin C. Geeting. Lydia Rebecca Follum Hoffman. Kevin Gregory Samuel Marsh. Sarah Nicole Menard. Oliver Cruiser Mesmer. Natalie Claire Owens Pike. Averyn C. A. Payne. Clara Elena Sims. Benjamin Christopher Smith. Jordan Seiler.
To the class of 2023, I'm very pleased to greet and congratulate you on behalf of our chairperson, Hannah Kane, and the entire advisory council for Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School as you receive your Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School diplomas. Owing to my service on the previous Board of Trustees, now Advisory Council, thanks to Andover Newton's permanent affiliation with YDS, I am fortunate to to have witnessed the superior leadership and dedication of Andover Newton Seminary Dean Sarah Drummond and staff working in tandem with YDS Dean Sterling and the YDS faculty to prepare you for this day. I am especially grateful to have had the privilege of meeting and becoming acquainted with many of you on past visits to YDS. Andover Newton's scholars, you have worked long and hard, and in this community you have acquired a quality education, received nurture, consciousness raising, cultivated community, and mentoring that will be vital to your success in leading with love in these precarious times. These times beg for well-trained moral leaders such as you are. Having personally lived, studied, worshiped, and prepared for the practice of ministry here at the Sterling Divinity Quadrangle, and graduated from this community, it struck me this morning, 35 years ago this month, I can attest to the quality, rigor, and relevance of your experiences at the Divinity School and throughout Yale University. Did you know that every experience, encounter, and engagement, whether pleasant or painful, that you have had, positive or negative, that you have had, intended or unintended, contains potential lessons which you may reference again and again in the course of your professional career? You are now positioned to assume global and local leadership in faith communities and in countless places and spaces where the demand exists for well-trained servant leaders. You are positioned and you are prepared. I read somewhere in the last 24 hours, a question about, does seminary prepare you? And my answer is yes, it does. And if seminary does not, where do you go to prepare? Your theological education combined with all the academic and practical experiences you have had up to now provide a sophisticated framework rooted in theological and ethical reflection, in historical knowledge, in spiritual and moral formation, and in critical interrogation of the foremost religious, social, and ethical issues facing our world today. And as you go, you will continue growing and gaining knowledge and wisdom from your experiences, so the learning never ends. For now, you have the academic credentials needed to go into all the world, to proclaim good news in troubled times, to make meaning in the midst of the meaninglessness in our day, from Main Street to the margins, to prophesy deliverance where that is called for, to use your intellect, your voice, your body, your heart, your soul, to announce that no matter what others say or do, the Creator God is still sovereign. As you move on from ANS at YDS, you do so not only with a diploma and with a degree in your possession, but also with the blessed assurance that God is on your side. Go forth with the confidence that you have been introduced and engaged in critical discussions, reflection, and engagement with the foremost thinkers of your discipline. Go forth with the gifts of mentors, classmates, and friends who have studied with you, laughed, cried, protested, and prayed with you during your time here. Go forth reclaiming citizenship in a local community, whether the one you came from or are going to for the first time. This is your season. And though it be filled with crisis and controversy, this is your season. Though the crisis in leadership across multiple sectors has never been more pronounced than it is now, this is your season. Though uncertainties may surface from time to time regarding your role, your position, your status, your compensation, or whatever, this is your season. Go in faith, believing that the same God who has provided for the generations long before now still provides, and you are on God's radar. finally, I congratulate you once again on receiving your diploma from Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School and on your YDS graduation. Well done.
Thank you, Dr. Hegre, and everyone else who's spoken this morning. It is such a gift to be with each of you this morning and celebrate this wonderful day that we have looked forward to together for so long, and to see all the people who kind of look like you, but a little older. It is my pleasure to represent the Student Steering Committee here as the rising convener. It is my privilege to connect our student body with our administration and staff, and I am so looking forward to continuing to serve in that role. And I want to congratulate you all on behalf of the students who will continue here and follow in the wonderful paths that you have laid out and the work that you have done. Each and every one of you has earned this diploma through your tireless efforts to leave this world better than you found it, and to do so leading with love. You all have set a high bar for what it is to be a class of students in Andover Newton here. You preach your truth, you advocate for wildlife, you give a voice to non-Christian students, you lead in student government, you build a more accessible future for YDS, you serve the Yale and New Haven community, you call us into nature, you create contemplative spaces, you perform in fabulous drag shows, you minister to student athletes, and you take us to transcendent places to open our minds. And for that, we thank you. For all of these gifts and for the sheer blessing of sharing your life with us, thank you. Those of us who remain here for another year or two, those of us who are just now starting the application process for YDS, those who are maybe in third or fourth grade have no idea that Andover Newton is part of their journey in the future. All of those people, every one of them, will benefit from your service, your dedication, and your spirit. To the class that has journeyed from the upper Zoom and creating a virtual Andover Newton reality, making the complex move into the hybrid and now in-person and a little uncertain and new feeling space that we call Andover Newton at YDS, you made it. Congratulations. Please come back and visit us often. And please invite us out into the places that you will serve, the churches, the nonprofits, the camps, the schools, everywhere where you will carry the spirit of Andover Newton into the world, now as alumni. Congratulations, job well done.
Hey Ned, as you're about to lead prayers, can I share a song to lead us into prayer?
I trust you more than I trust anyone, so you go.
As our preacher was giving the sermon today, and as the rain fell outside, I realized she was asking us to choose love. And the words are, in the midst of pain, I choose love. In the midst of pain, sorrow falling down like rain, I await the sun again. I choose love. So we can sing that together.
In the midst of pain, I choose love. In the midst of pain, I choose love. In the midst of pain, sorrow falling down like rain, I await the sun again. I choose love. I choose love.
When my world falls down, you say,
when my world falls down, I will rise. When my world falls down,
explanations.
Explanations can't be found. I will climb to holy ground. I will rise. I will rise.
Let me sing. In the midst of pain, I choose love.
In the midst of pain, I choose love. In the midst of pain, I choose love. In the midst of pain, sorrow falling down like rain, I await the sun.
Will you pray with me? O God, who goes by many names, but for whom no label is sufficient. Creator God, Mother, Father, the Theophanous, they, them, unlimited and unfathomable love. For these graduates, we give thanks. For their families, biological, adopted, chosen, we give thanks. For all the saints who have encouraged them from cloud-borne castles or earthly optimism, we lift our gratitude to you, O God. For the faculty and staff who have supported them, listened to them, encouraged them, offered wisdom and knowledge to them, and indeed learned from them, we say thank you, God. Truly, this class has come together for a while and asked where to begin. To build a world where love can grow and hope can indeed enter in ways unexpected, they've been the hands of healing and planted seeds of peace. Thank you, God. I ask that you grant them peace, knowing this part is now finished. Grant them the strength to endure the questions that remain, and grant them the perception to recognize this shared journey through pandemic and isolation and return and classes and meetings and Emmaus and prayerful intercession and final exams. All of this has bonded them together through the Holy Spirit, ever present, always intertwining, and perpetually building beautiful bastions of belonging, no matter where they, you, may be. Thank you, God. And with boldness, we still ask for one other thing, yet more love. To let love linger, to let love ignite lighthouse lanterns, allowing love to last and sanctify the salvific strength of your sacred signature, O God, by leading with love, inspiring imagination, increasing the incalculable inclusivity of the incarnation, to lead with a love loftier, larger, lovelier, to heal human hearts, to heal hardened hummus, to heal the hell in this kingdom of heaven. That their communities be clusters of compassion because of them, pods of peace, homes of hope, way stations for the wayward, belonging a byproduct, bravery their ballast, and gratitude grafted with grace on their gatherings. From everlasting to everlasting, through the ethereal evolution of eternity, compelled by a calling, crying from cosmos to cathedral to classroom to colloquium, their comfortable, clabbered containers for communion, to lead with love. Gracious God, with your power already at work within them, we anoint their heads so that they may be living blessings to a wondrous, wonderful world in need of their love leadership. I pray in the name of the one who loved unto death and then loved back into life. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you. Congratulations. Each of you has arrived in this sacred space today because you not only heard, but you also answered God's call to you. Your well-earned diplomas and medals acknowledge a journey into the shimmering unknown of this faith we hold on to. With all that carried you to your first days in New Haven, and all that you will now carry away from Andover Newton Seminary, we on the Alumni Council have a gift for you. Tucked into the ceremony and the celebration today is a treasure of being an Andover Newton graduate. Your friend network has just bumped up by about 6,000 people. Living alums scattered across all of these United States and around the world, you have joined the ranks of some fairly amazing folks. Welcome. In the fold of Andover Newton alums are preachers, teachers, vocal advocates for LGBTQI+, their rights, youth ministers, hospice chaplains, small church pastors, gun reform advocates, justice warriors, spiritual directors, big city pulpit dwellers, and rural shepherds, or maybe the dogs, whose flocks are small but mightily faithful. We're everywhere, those of us blessed by Andover Newton's mission statement. Deeply rooted in Christian faith and radically open to what God is doing now. Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School educates inspiring leaders for faith communities. Welcome to the fold. We are so glad you're here. Reach out to us wherever you are. We'll be reaching out to you. If you're unsure how to find us, Sarah and Ned will help you connect with seeming strangers, but not really strangers. The people I studied with throughout my tenure at Andover Newton are in San Diego, Washington State, Iowa, Tennessee, Maine, Rhode Island, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, and all over Massachusetts, from Springfield to Andover, from Methuen to the Cape. It's a wide net, Andover Newton's graduate we cast, a very wide net. And it's a broad world unfolding of your treasured learning here. Those of us on the Alumni Council did not sit in class together. Our graduation dates span over four decades. We've met as alums and worked together to create supportive endeavors for God's servants whose task it is and will be to carry this blessed work forward. Over and over in his first letter to the community of Christians in Thessaloniki, Paul wrote, "Encourage one another. Encourage one another and build each other up." In a world that values civility less and less, while desperately yearning for a snippet of good news, God's call to us, to you, can be challenging, some days wearying. The network of support you've inherited is a hefty Rolodex to which each of your names has now been added. Welcome. Congratulations. We look forward to getting to know you in the years ahead. May the God of mystery and blessing accompany you this day and every day going forward.
In body or in spirit, I invite you to rise and hear these words of blessing. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, who created you, redeemed you, and will forever sustain you, be with you now and remain with you all forever. Amen.
I need and I am fed. You give me life. You know my ways, my strength, my path for all my days. My strength, my path for all my days.
All my days.